He traveled around the world and saw a lot during his time as a member of the United States Navy. He's invited us along to recount some of his experiences.
That's right. United States Navy Captain John B. Mitchell is joining us. And you served our country, and now you're sharing your experiences. And the book is right here on the table, Seven Ships. But first of all, thank you for your service. And
thank you.
Where were you? Seven ships, obviously, but how long did you serve, and what did you do?
I spent 30 years in the Navy. Served on seven ships and shore duty for the other time, about 2 years per each ship. The book is only about the service on the seven ships and the seven deployments of 6 months or longer that I made, with one exception, which we'll talk about in a few minutes.
Well, let's go into, you have some really fascinating stories, and one we were talking about before the show has to do with something local here, Mayport. Tell us about that.
Okay, well, that's the exception when I talk in the book about it, so we can go right to that. I served from 1987 to 1989 as a commanding officer of Naval Station Mayport. During that period of time, people may recall, viewers may recall, that the USS Stark, a guided missile frigate homeported in Mayport, was in the Persian Gulf on patrol and was attacked by an Iraqi fighter jet who fired missiles at the ship, and ultimately 37 sailors lost their lives. We at Naval Station Mayport became the focal point for caring for the families of those 37 sailors. About half of them actually lived here in Mayport, and the other half came for the memorial service later on. But so we were involved in caring for the families, and then later in that week of the attack, Naval Station Mayport hosted the memorial service for those 37 sailors, which was attended by President and Mrs. Reagan.
Mm. Commanding officer of Mayport, that's the guy in charge, correct?
Correct.
And for how many years did you do that?
2 years.
A friend of, probably you know him, John Delaney. Passed away a few years ago and stuff.
Kevin Delaney, sorry, wrong Delaney there.
What was your experience as far as with the seven different ships? Do you have a favorite port?
A lot of favorite ports, but the one I think I would have to say is my most favorite is Hong Kong.
Nice. Why so?
Hong Kong is elegant. Hong Kong is sophisticated. Hong Kong has wonderful shopping, wonderful dining, and Hong Kong appears in the movies. As I was mentioning, all you have to do is catch the Star Ferry from Hong Kong across the harbor to Kowloon, and you're right in the role of the movie The World of Susie Wong, because she rode back and forth on the Star Ferry. Well, Hong Kong's just a great place.
Talking about a movie, this Seven Ships book may be a movie. You never know. You never know. Never say never. But tell us, Captain, why did you decide to write this book? Seven ships, you have one tour around the world.
Well, and that was basically it. About 5 years ago, I started thinking, you know, I bet there are things that I have seen and done that my family and close friends probably don't realize, don't know about, and maybe I ought to start writing them down while I can still remember them. And the first one and the primary example is just what you mentioned. On my very first ship after commissioning, we made an around-the-world cruise, around-the-world deployment.
I mean, no one can say they did around-the-world cruise. That's amazing in itself.
Very few people. And the other point is, 30 years in the Navy, I never did it again.
Yeah,
so it was somewhat unique.
That was definitely unique, because that was how you started your whole career.
Exactly.
And what did that for you going into it? But you told me something interesting in the break, that your entire time in the Navy, you were excited every day to get up and go to work. So this
Absolutely. Wasn't
didn't feel like a job to you.
Oh no. Certainly not on the ships. Shore duty, you know, becomes a little more like an office job. But still, you're working with the ships and with the sailors and with the people, and that's what makes it great. That's absolutely what makes it great.
Another great story that you shared was something to do with when you were in Vietnam and you had a minesweep.
I had command of a minesweeper, USS Engage, toward the end of the Vietnam War. We were a part of Task Force 78, which was a task force formed to clear the minefields that the U.S. Navy laid a year earlier off of the North Vietnamese ports of Haiphong, Vinh, and several others. So we were there, a group of ships, helos, sailors, and Marines, clearing guaranteeing that those minefields were cleared. And to our extreme joy, one day we were told to tune into to a radio frequency at a specific time while we were sweeping, and we got to hear the voice of a U.S. Air Force transport pilot announcing that he was airborne with the first load of U.S. prisoners of war on their way home to,
wow,
to home and freedom.
Wow.
That night, however, we anchored that night, all the ships did, and suddenly we got a high precedence message ordering us all to weigh anchor and get underway. It seems that earlier that day, the North Vietnamese had informed the U.S. Navy contingent that they were displeased with some of the negotiations going on and refused to allow any more POWs to be released and sent home.
Wow.
So we were at sea, amazing, at sea, out of sight when they woke up the next morning. And this mine clearance was very important to them because it had stopped all their seaborne commerce for over a year. So they woke up the next morning, there's nobody there. Woke up the next morning, there's nobody there. 5 days went by, we just stayed at sea. And finally, the North Vietnamese said, all right, we're going to resume allowing the
POWs. Appreciate your time and service, appreciate your time on the show. We'll be right back. This is amazing, amazing stories.